right. It's always a good idea before you create a web page to sort of sketch it out and have an idea of what you're going to do. It would be like writing a paper in English class. When you write a paper in English class, ideally, you should have an idea of what you're going to say and not just sit down and start typing away. You know, in an English class, you might have an outline, for example. You might create an outline. There's a number of things that you can do to plan a web page, depending on how complicated it is and so on, you know. And we'll talk about that, and a lot of that is the process of design. Design is an important consideration in web development, but design doesn't just mean, you know, what colors you use and what fonts you use. You know, design has a lot to do with how you organize the information on your page and how you lay out the page and putting space between things on the page and things of that things of that nature. So it's important that we consider these two things side by side. You need both the technical skills to develop a web page, but you also need the design skills. That's really what's interesting about web development, is if you totally lack in one of those areas, you're not going to develop good web pages. If you don't have the technical skills, then your stuff isn't going to work. You know, the links aren't going to work and so on. If you don't have the design skills, you're going to design pages and sites that, I mean, they display in a browser, but they don't help the user accomplish their goals, what they need to do. So there's a number of things that you can do. One of the things, and we'll talk about this a little bit more later on, is to kind of sketch a wireframe. A wireframe is sort of like an overview of what the site's going to look like. So today in class, we're going to go over an example of creating a frequently asked questions page. And we're going to look at an example on the web, and we're going to try to imitate that. But before we do that, I'd like to sort of sketch out what our page is going to look like. This is our page. We're going to have sort of a banner on the top of the page. Most of the pages have a banner on the top that talks about what organization's running this page, what the purpose of the page is, sort of the information about identifying who's made this page for what purpose and so on. It's important to have that, because if you don't have that, people, the way the web works and the way that you can click around going from link to link, person may land on your page and really have no idea who you are. All right, so it's important to identify the organization. In our frequently asked questions page, we're going to have navigation, where we have a list of questions. And each of those questions is going to have a section on the page. And so on. And when you click to on a number, for example, if I were to click on number 3, that question is going to jump to the top of the page. All right? Then we'll also have a link that will say back to top, that will go back and display the page on the top. So there we are, sketched out. Again, the sketch doesn't have to be elaborate. It's just a way to sort of get your ideas down first. Now, initially in this class, before we start talking about CSS to any great degree, our sketches would be pretty simple, because we don't know things like how to control the layout, and how to put things side by side, and how to put things, you know, that stay at the bottom of the page and stuff like that. We'll learn that stuff. So as we go through this class, our sketches are going to get more and more complicated. But it's good to get in the habit of doing that, because again, designing the pages is, of the utmost importance. All right, you want to develop pages that are going to be very usable, and you want to do some planning in advance to accomplish this. All right, so in doing this, we're going to do some old tags. We're going to do some new tags. All right, so here we go. The one thing I do want to emphasize, though, when I speak about design, is that design, again, relates to making pages that are effective, not just the way pages look. All right, so here's an example that I picked. title of this page. Someone wants to get the lights. I picked a frequently asked questions from OpenOffice. OpenOffice is a open source office suite, similar to Microsoft Office, but it's absolutely free. And I think I like to use open source software because I don't like to pay, and I like to use it legally. All right, so open source software is developed by sort of just a community of people that work on it. It's kind of very interesting. So I definitely support open source software. So, frequently asked questions example on the web, and you'll see a lot of ones that fit this mold. All right, so notice what I said, and again, there's some extra stuff in here, but this basically fits the sketch that I had. There's a banner on the top that tells you what this is. This is Apache's OpenOffice, the free and open productivity suite. Some other stuff about it, and we'll ignore this stuff, but you can consider that to be part of the header as well. Over here, you have the navigation. All right, for the overview. There's a list of 11 questions. Now notice what happens when you click the link. These are different kinds of links than the links that we saw on Thursday last week. These will not take me to a new page. These will take me to a different section of this page, sort of a different kind of link. So, if I click this, for example, what components are included in OpenOffice? Notice I essentially scrolled to that portion of the page. All right, I scrolled to that portion of the page. Then I can click back on top to scroll back. So these are not, I can get to all the answers by scrolling if I want, or if I know I'm interested in a particular question, I can click to it and go right to that answer. All right. This is very common for frequently asked questions pages, because rather than having a million little pages, each which answer one question, you have all your questions answered on one page, then people can either scroll through them and read them from top to bottom, or they can click on the navigation if they're just interested in a specific question. So this is a nice simple design that is very effective for this kind of page. All right, so definitely, you know, even though this isn't an elaborate page, it's a well designed. It would help me serve my goals. It would help the users visiting the site serve their goals, and that is either to get a comprehensive overview or to answer a specific question. Okay. So, let's see, what else did I have to say about this? Keep losing my train of thought today. I don't know if it's the weather or what. Okay, let's go and build a page like this. All right? So, I'm going to go into Notepad. And I've had a couple people ask me if they can use Macs, and absolutely, my laptop is a Mac. There's any number of different applications that you can use on a Mac if you do have a Mac. There's one I like to use called Text Wrangler. That's TextWrangler. All right. So if you're using a Mac, feel free to download and use that. It's free. All right. The idea of using a plain text editor is we are typing the tags in, all right? There are other tools that are used in web development where you sort of drag and drop stuff on the page and it sort of does the HTML coding for you. I don't think you really learn HTML coding if you use those. So therefore, we're going to use just a plain old text editor. And I picked Notepad simply because the computer here in the classroom is a Windows machine, and Notepad's about as simple as it gets. People have asked me if you could use Notepad++, and absolutely you could use Notepad++. Notepad++ is very similar to Notepad, but it does offer some nice little features. But it doesn't do the work for you, all right? We want to have the fun. We don't want to let someone else have the fun. All right, so I'm going to go in here in a Notepad, and I'm going to start out by putting the basic tags that are on every single page, along with the doc type declaration. Remember, the very first line of an HTML document, an HTML5 document specifically, and I can't type today either, is not really a tag, but it's a declaration. This helps identify to the browser that indeed the browser is dealing with an HTML document. There's a few different things that are sort of used for different purposes, but taken together, they identify the same thing, that, hey, this is an HTML document. All right. I then have my HTML tag. And the HTML tag goes around everything on the page. Everything on the page is nested within the HTML tag. It's a real good habit to get into, to as soon as you put the starting tag, to put the ending tag. Because then you don't forget to go back in. You know, there's always a chance that you're going to forget and go back and put the ending tag in. So put this ending tag as soon as you put the starting tag, and then you'll never have that problem. Yeah, I see a lot of things that I grade that don't have ending body and ending HTML tags. Do the pages work? Yes. Is there a possibility that somewhere down the line that could burn you? Also, yes. So remember, we want to follow the rules of the language as close as possible. Because if we don't follow the rules, the results are unpredictable. We saw examples last time where I broke an HTML rule, and really nothing happened. Really didn't matter. We saw other examples where I broke an HTML rule and the whole page didn't display. So somewhere between those two possibilities, you know, something's going to happen. Yes?
How come the document type declaration doesn't need a closing tag?
Because it's not really a tag, it's a declaration.
Okay.
Yeah, it's just it sort of looks like a tag, but it's not really a tag. The other thing to note is keep in mind that I speak in very general terms. I will say, for example, that all, you know, tags have ending tags. There are exceptions to that as well. But it's a good practice to always have an ending tag for a starting tag. Okay, the two main sections of an HTML page are the head and the body. And I will put these in right off the bat as well as their respective ending tags. And the only thing that we've learned that goes in the head tag right now is the title of the page. I'll do a simple web development FAQ. Alright. Now, here's a couple new tags. And remembering our example, which we brought up, The new tags we are going to create now deal with the different portions of our page. For example, we looked at our frequently asked questions example off the web. We saw that there was a header section, there's a navigation section, and then there's a separate section for each answer. All right? So there are tags to define those portions of the page. There's a tag to define the header portion of the page. There is a tag to define the navigation of the page. There's a tag to define the different sections of the page, like answer one, answer two, and so on. And there's also a tag for stuff like this, which is called a footer, that appears at the bottom of the page. And they all serve their role. They all tell the browser, like, what this section of the page means. All right? So we're going to put those in. And these are four new tags, I think. Yeah, we'll have four new tags. Header. Nav. Section in fact we're actually going to have several sections, right? We're going to have a section for each answer. And then finally, we're going to have a footer. And I'm not going to turn the light back on and show my drawing. But if you remember back to what my drawing looked like, these will pretty much correspond to the different blocks that I drew on the screen, on the board. All right, I had a header at the very top. And I then had a navigation where I had the list of the frequently asked questions. I then had a section for each answer. And then I had, I think I forgot to draw the footer on the screen, on the board, but you can imagine there'd be a footer at the very bottom of the page. So let's go in, first of all, and start doing the header and the footer. All right? So. Now, this is a case of, don't blame me, I'm just a teacher, all right? I know it's confusing that there's a head section, there's a header section, and then there's heading tags, all right? Keep in mind, I didn't make that up, all right? I'm just teaching you the way these standards were defined. The head section is where you put the title, is one of the two main sections of the page. The header section I would describe as being a banner, because it's sort of a banner that goes across the top of the page. All right? And then the heading tags are the individual headlines that describe the content of the page. So I'm going to go in here and I'm going to say my heading is going to be Web Development Frequently Asked Questions page. I put that in an H1 tag. Why? Because that's sort of a top level heading. Alright? If I was making an outline, this would be the top level of the outline. Alright? Now I can also make a paragraph that maybe says a little bit more about this. Mike Zellers defined this page to help his students at Lorain County Community College. So that's the heading, or I'm sorry, the header. It defines the purpose of the page. All right. And again, it doesn't matter where I put those extra spaces in. All right. The browser reduces all those extra spaces into single spaces, so it's not going to put those things on three lines like I have it here. In the footer, I'm going to put something like this. I'm going to put a paragraph that says, email Mike Zellers at mzellers@lorainecc.edu. With any questions. All right. So, I'm going to save it and see how it looks in the browser. That's one thing I do when I create web pages, or really when I develop any sort of software, is I try not to do too much at one time without testing it. So, I created this web page. I'm nowhere near done with this web page. All right, there's still a lot of stuff that has to be done. All right, but I'm going to save it and I'm going to look at it to make sure that the part that I've done so far looks good. All right, and I do that for a number of reasons. I don't want to have to type in an entire web page and then when I'm done look and find 50 different problems with it. I would rather do a little bit of code, look at the page, see if it's right. If it's right, go on to the next piece of code. If I look at the next piece of code and there's a problem, I know it's probably something that I added, right? If part A worked and part B doesn't, it's probably the stuff that I added between part A and part B that's causing the problem. Plus, it's good. It gives you a nice feeling of accomplishment. Like at the end of the day, let's say it was quitting time for me. If I at least got this much done. I might not be done with the whole page, but at least the parts that I did I know work. So I think it's good for a number of reasons, both in terms of troubleshooting the work that you've done, and just in terms of your own attitude. I think it's good to say, hey, I'm not done with everything, but the pieces I have done do work. All right. So I'm going to go and save this. So I'll go up in File, Save. I'm going to change text document to All Files. And I'm going to save on the desktop. I'm going to call it faq.html. I'm going to save it. I can now view this in a browser. And there we go. Shows the header and the footing, the header and the footer correctly, just the way that I intended it. The title's right. Oh, wait a minute, this one. The title's right. The heading, H1, is right. This paragraph displays correctly. And the footer displays correctly. So far, so good. All right? Any questions about this? All right. The next thing we're going to do is we're going to define a list of the frequently asked questions. Now I'm going to make up 4 or 5 of them, all right? So you'd have as many of them as you think necessary. That would be part of the design process, right? Is figuring out what are really the frequently asked questions to put on this page. You know, you don't want to have too few questions because you want to answer as many questions as possible. Then again, you might not want to have a million questions on the page because that'll make it harder for people to find the answer that they're interested in. So you find a balance of what you think truly the most frequently asked questions are on a page, and you come up with it. I'm going to come up with 5 of them. All right? These are a list of 5 questions. And remember, this list is going to be my navigation. All right? Now, in order to do a list, I'm going to create a list tag. All right? My navigation is going to be a list of questions/links. And right now, we're going to go and we're going to make them be a list. All right? They're just going to be plain text now. Then in a minute, I'm going to turn them into a link. So, UL is a tag for unordered list. What do I mean by unordered list? An unordered list is a list where the order was chosen, but there isn't sort of a natural order it goes into, if that makes any sense. So let's think of some questions, all right? What is HTML? I'll make 3 questions. What is CSS? What is JavaScript? All right. These are 3 frequently asked questions. Notice what my list looks like. My list starts with a UL tag that says, here's the beginning of my list. This list is unordered, which means I could have asked these questions in any order and it really wouldn't matter. What is CSS could be the first question. What is HTML could be the second. What is JavaScript could be the third. Really doesn't matter the order. It's not like, for example, if I did a ranking, all right? What would be an example of a ranking? You know, what were the top ranked movies this week, right? You have the top, the number one top ranked movie is the one that most people went to. Number 2 is the second most people went to, and so on down the line. Right. That's a ranking. That, it would change the meaning of the list if I had it rearranged. If I said, here's a ranking, but I'm putting number 7 first, and then number 3, and then number 8, that wouldn't make any sense. So an ordered list has to be in an order to make sense. An unordered list, really, you could change the order, and it really doesn't mess things up. All right. So I'm going to make this an unordered list. So I have a UL at the very beginning of my unordered list. And I have an end UL at the very end of my list. Each list item is in an LI tag. So my first list item is this. Second list item is this. Third list item is this. So I have an unordered list with 3 list items. All right. I have not made those links yet, notice. We'll come around to making those links in a couple minutes. But right now, there's simply a list of frequently asked questions. Again, I'm going to save it and see what I have, because I don't want to do too much and then wait till the end and view and see all the different problems I have. So we have a list, right? And notice that it's a bulleted list. It's a bulleted list because I defined it as a UL. All right? So a UL list, an unordered list, gets displayed as a bulleted list. Notice that the LI are blocked. On its own line. arms that are all block tags. So really, everything that we've seen so far, with the exception of the A tag, is a block tag. All right, the A tag is an inline tag, which means if you remember last time when I put a link in, the link wasn't on a line by itself. It was just in the middle of the paragraph. Okay. Now I'm going to go and I'm going to come up with my three sections. All right. What is HTML? What is CSS? And what is JavaScript? All right. So I'm going to put H2s in here. Now, I don't want to sit here and type a long definition of what HTML is, right? Yet, I do want to have some real paragraphs here, just so that when I'm designing it, I know what it's going to look like, right? In other words, this is going to be, the answer to this question is probably going to be a couple of paragraphs. Yet, I don't want to stop my design to sit and write that. I'll go and write that later. So what designers have done for years, even back when they didn't do web pages, but if they were laying out books or magazines or things like that, they use what is called Greek text. It's not really Greek. Think of it as being fake text. It's just words that you put in that actually, that sort of are placeholders, but show you what it will look like when it's completed. So I'm going to go, and I'm going to look Google Greek text. And here's a page about Greek text. Lorem ipsum is sort of what Greek text starts with. I'm going to go and ask for two paragraphs of Greek text. And it will generate two paragraphs of fake text that I could include in my document. So I'm going to go copy that, put it in my document. So you don't have to sit here and watch me try to type all this stuff in. So I'll put a paragraph, an end paragraph, another end paragraph, and start paragraph. So if I go and look at this in the browser, I'm going to go and save it again. Notice all I'm doing, once I've saved it once with an HTML extension, all I have to do is go to File, Save, and then refresh in the browser. All right, so there. Again, it doesn't really say anything meaningful, but at least I know what this page is going to look like when I do get around to actually putting the text in. All right? Questions about this? It's okay to do this when you're planning a page, but you should never turn in a page with Greek text in. All right? Take the time to write the actual text for it. But when you're just sort of planning it out and creating a page and laying it out, it's a nice little placeholder to have. All right? And I'm going to go copy this three times, one for each section. right. So now, here's what my page looks like. I have my three questions. Each of the questions have a section, and each of the sections has some dummy text in it, some just placeholder text. So let's review what we have so far. All right. We have the same basic tags that we said last time are going to be on every page. We have a header. It's the banner going across of the page, across the top of the page, that defines the purpose of the page. All right. We have the footer, which is the stuff that we want to appear on the bottom of the page, and a lot of times it's like how to contact the creator of the web page, or copyright information, or legal disclaimers, or anything like that. We have a navigation section, which for right now consists only of an unordered list of our frequently asked questions. And then finally, we have a section for each frequently asked questions, each section having an H2, which defines what the section's about, and then finally two paragraphs of dummy or placeholder text. Any questions on what we have so far? And you can imagine we could have a whole bunch of these, right? And let's say we had 20 questions. We wouldn't have, and the page would be really, really long. We wouldn't want to have to scroll to get to the bottom of the page. We would want to be able to click a link and jump to the bottom of it. In fact, just for, we'll leave it as it is. We can illustrate the point with that. Now what I want to do is I want to be able to jump to any point in the page, any of the questions in the page, simply by clicking on it. So I don't have to scroll. So that my navigation will take me to a section of the page. Now, this is also a link tag. And this also has an href attribute. The href attribute, however, won't be a web page. It will be the ID of a part of the page or section of the page. So what do I mean by that? Well, what is HTML? I'm going to make a link out of that. Whoops. And a link, if you remember last time, is the A tag. It has an href attribute to say, this is where I want you to go to. And when we did this last time, we put in the name of another web page. We put in, I think, Lorain County Community College web page and University of Akron's web page and so on. In this case, though, we don't want to go to another web page. We want to go to a section of the page. We want to go to an ID within the page. So in order to do that, you don't put in the name of a web page. You do this. You put the pound sign or the hashtag, depending on how old you are. You then put the ID that identifies the section of the page that you want to go to. So I want to go to, let's say, the section one or the question one section of the page. Or the HTML question of the page, section of the page. Actually, this is the HTML answer. So I'll call it pound sign HTML answer. All right. We close the A tag. We close the start A tag. We have this text in here. We then have the closing A tag. All right? Now, we're not done yet, but I want to show you what it looks like. Looks like a link, all right, which is what we want. We want to tell the user that it's a link. Alright. Notice that by default it's blue and underlined. Alright. That's the default way of signifying a link. Can we change that? You bet we can change that. Anything about the appearance of the page, we can change via CSS. So if we want links to be instead red with a yellow background, we can make our links red with a yellow background. All right. However, if I click on that link, nothing happens. Why not? Well, because we haven't defined what section of the page I mean by # HTML answer. How do you do that? You do it this way. You go in, and this is where the HTML answer begins, right? So I'm going to go in, and I'm going to say ID equals HTML answer. Now, this is an attribute, right? It's part of the H2 tag. It's not a separate tag by itself. It's additional information about the H2 tag. It's an ID for that HTML tag. Now, what do we know about IDs? Your student ID number. Are there two people in this classroom that have the same student ID number? I hope not, right? Are there two people on campus that have the same ID number? I hope not. IDs mean that they're unique, you know. And what do I mean by unique? Unique means that there's no duplicates allowed, all right? Everyone has to have their own ID. And IDs and HTML code are the same way. There can only be one thing on the page that has an ID of HTML answer. Why? Well, if I say I want to jump to that section, I better know the one place on the page that corresponds to that section. There shouldn't be two places I could possibly jump to and let the browser pick one. That doesn't make any sense. All right? So I'm going to save this and refresh. Now, I'm going to imagine my window is small. Notice what happens when I click this link. I jump to that section of the page. Now, so I haven't gone to a new page, but I've jumped to that section on the page. And notice that the URL up in the address bar now shows # HTML answer. All right. Let's go and do the same thing for the other two. So I'll call this one CSS answer, and I'll call this one JS answer. All right. So I've given them each a unique ID. There's no two things that have the same ID. That's a rule. All right. Remember, what happens if you break the rule? In HTML and in web development, it's up in the air. It might work without a problem, or you might not get the exact results that you want. So the bottom line is obey the rules, and then you have the best chance of getting the results that you want. So I'm now going to convert these other two to look like HTML. Again, go and refresh it. Now all three of them show up as links. Question, you should be able to tell from the screen, the top link looks different than the other two links. The top link is, I believe, magenta, and the other two links are blue. Just like the dog in Blue's Clues was blue and the cat was magenta, if my memory holds. All right? Why is the top link magenta and the bottom two links blue?
Shows that
you already clicked on it. And that's a nice thing to put, nice feature to put on your web page. All right? If you have a site with a lot of pages, it helps a user if they're looking for something, if they know they've already visited a certain page. Because if they're looking for something, they haven't found it yet, if they see that they visited that page already, well, they know not to go back there. All right? It's a reminder, hey, you've already been there. Or the reverse is true. If I think, hey, I remember seeing this really good article on this website, I want to go back to it, showing the links that you visited helps you say, oh, maybe it was this one, and you could click on it. All right, so that's a browser default. The way your page looks is a combination of two things, the defaults of the browser and the CSS. All right, now, we don't know any CSS yet. We haven't gone over any CSS yet. So everything that we see in the browser, everything we see now on our web page is based on the browser default. So we have these links now set up, and we can click and get to the What is JavaScript section. What is CSS? What is HTML? All right. Now, if you notice the example that I had, and this would especially be valuable if I had a lot of questions. If I imagine if I had 20 questions on this page. If I clicked on the very last question, I would go to the very bottom of all 20 questions. It would sort of be a pain to scroll up all the way back to the top. So a lot of frequently asked questions, including the one that we viewed, says 11, but notice there's a back to top link. If I click that, I go up to the navigation. Alright. Now I could send it back to the navigation, or I could send it just to the back to the top of the page. I'm going to send it back to the top of the page. So you do that by going and saying a href equals pound sign back to top. Now you don't have to define anything special for the pound sign. The pound sign is already understood to be the very top of the page. So you don't have to go in and put an ID on something on the top of the page. So I can do that with each of these. And now, if I go to a section, I have a back to top link. If I click that, boom, I'm back up to the top. There's a cool and exciting thing about developing on the web. I mean, notice that, you know, we're 3 days into the class, and already functionally, we have more or less duplicated how this looks, right? Or how it acts, anyhow. We haven't put images on here, and there's some things that we don't have, but in the most part, we have gone in and we've created a simple, frequently asked questions page that could be very usable, just with the tags that we know, all right? And, well, with the tags that we knew plus a few extra tags that we went over today. Are there any questions over this example? Okay. There's a few more things I want to show with this, so we'll pick up on this example on Thursday and polish it up. And then we probably will start talking about CSS, because I don't like to let CSS go too long For one thing, students get real impatient, and they don't want their web pages to look boring anymore. They want to add something to them. Now, keep in mind that my lectures typically run a little bit of ahead of what the lab assignments are. So my lab assignments may have a certain requirement, and we may have learned more stuff. You're allowed to do more on your lab than what is required. So if you want to play around with any of these new tags, you're welcome to, or any CSS, or anything you already know, or anything that you read in the book. All right. So you don't have to only do what was assigned. Feel free to have fun with it and do as much as you want. All right. We will see you.